Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching Top 10's Net, and in the video today, viruses that are actually making the world a better place. Viruses are a particularly fearsome germ. Though viral infections may resemble bacterial infections, antibiotics are useless against viruses. There are indeed very few dedicated antivirals to kill them off. But who even knows if kill is the right word to use for something that stretches the definition of life? Viruses, they're microscopically tiny zombie robots hijacking cells and turning them into factories for themselves. But humanity can exploit viruses' supremely odd workings and sneaky ways for their own purposes, and that's what we're looking at in today's video. Number 10. Blue eggs. If you've ever wanted to find some green eggs for some Dr. Seuss-style green eggs and ham, well, you're in luck. Thanks to a virus, you don't even need the eggs to be from some exotic wild bird. Most chicken eggs are white or brown, but a few chickens lay eggs that are green or blue. These breeds include the Chilean Mapuche breed, its descendant breeds, the Araucana, and the Chinese Dongshang and Luxi breeds. Two things are responsible for the colorful eggs: viral infections and blood. Long ago, a Mapuche fowl was found infected by a retrovirus, a virus which can insert its genetic code into the host's. The retrovirus's effect was to trigger the buildup of biliverdin in the eggshell, a breakdown product from a part of hemoglobin that can cause a greenish tint to bruises. The Dongshang and Luxi breeds developed their colorful eggs independently, but from the same viral course. According to historical evidence, the Dongshang breed has the bluish-green egg mutation since at least 500 years ago, and the Mapuche fowl since between 200 to 500 years ago. The trait is autosomal dominant, so chickens only need one parent with the mutation in order for themselves to lay the colorful eggs. However, those who have both copies of the gene variant lay darker colored eggs. Number 9. Tulip-breaking virus. For the beauty of a virus-infected egg, one only has to pay a little more than usual. But for a beautiful virus-infected tulip in the Netherlands of the 17th century, one had to pay a lot more. Back then, some tulips mysteriously had beautiful streaking and feathering patterns. These were the so-called broken tulips. These were so expensive that they could even leave their owners broke, as well as the entire Dutch economy. In 1623, some bulbs were sold for 1,000 florins, when the average annual income was 150 florins. Due to their high price, it cost less for some citizens to get still-life paintings of broken tulips than the actual tulips themselves. Their beauty was short-lived, as the broken tulip's bulbs shrank over successive generations. Eventually, it could no longer flower, and it soon died. No one knew what caused the tulips to break. People turned to all sorts of odd things, including pigeon dung, in order to reproduce the pattern. It was later discovered a virus called protivirus made the tulips break. The infection spread through aphids or by contact with an infected tulip. The virus worked by affecting the distribution of the pigment anthocyanin. Today, such tulips are still costly, but for the damage protivirus causes to gardens rather than their beauty, protivirus-infected tulips, once so valuable, are now carefully weeded out of gardens. Now there are specially bred tulips that mimic the patterns of a broken tulip without the need for the virus. Number 8. Electricity-making virus. Computer viruses were named after their biological counterparts. Now biological viruses, well, they're leading back to electronics. Some solids build electric charges when compressed. This is called the piezoelectric effect, and it's most well known in quartz watches. The piezoelectric effect has several applications, but materials used to make piezoelectric devices are toxic and difficult to work with. This limits the widespread use of this effect. Berkeley lab scientists could change that, though, with a virus. They used the M13 phage virus, which targets bacteria and is harmless to humans. It's useful for several reasons. It multiplies itself by millions, naturally arranges itself in orderly films like chopsticks in a box, and is easy to genetically engineer. The ease in genetically engineering it helps scientists boost its voltage, and its self-arrangement helps with the goal of self-assembly in nanotechnology. The Berkeley lab scientists tested their approach by making a generator. The generator works by tapping a finger on a stamp-sized electrode patch coated with viruses. The viruses then turn the force of the tap into electricity, producing enough current to operate a liquid crystal display. With this technology, future devices could be charged from the vibrations of everyday tasks, such as climbing the stairs or shutting doors. Number 7. Battery virus. Some computer and smartphone owners worry about viruses that can overclock their devices' batteries and leave them with a useless metal brick. But biological viruses could do the opposite. They could make batteries better. In 2006, scientists at MIT used a virus called M13 to make part of a battery. This part, the anode, is part of a pair of poles in the battery with opposite electrical charges. In 2009, the scientists completed the trickier task of making the anode's counterpart, the cathode. To make it work, the scientists had to tweak two of the virus's genes. The first gene made proteins in the virus's coat. The modifications allowed bits of iron phosphate to stick to it and bulge like tiny fists all along the length of the virus, in the words of study co-author Angela M. Belcher. The second gene let carbon nanotubes attach, forming a network of millions of electricity-conducting viruses. To make similar technologies, extremely high temperatures of about 660 degrees Fahrenheit, that's 350 degrees Celsius, were needed. However, the researchers could turn M13 into a battery-making tool at or below room temperature. According to Belcher, a third of an ounce, that's 10 grams of the virus, could power an iPod for 40 hours. However, she believes it's more suitable for large, high-power things like electric cars. In 2013, progress was made on that goal. With viruses, lithium batteries of electric cars could be greatly improved. The M13 virus was used to make manganese oxide nanowires for lithium-air batteries. Unlike typically made nanowires of the metal, the virus wires had a rough, spiky surface, which greatly increased the wire's surface area. The increase in surface area could be a big advantage in the battery's charging rate. The process had other benefits too, such as an increased electrode stability and less need for expensive metals like palladium for the batteries. Number 6. Cancer-fighting viruses. Herpes and cancer, two diseases people rarely want to talk about. But using herpes to fight cancer, well, that's definitely worth discussing. Imlygic is a new anti-cancer drug. On average, it extends melanoma patients' lives by less than 4.5 months. This is barely statistically significant, but Imlygic is special. It's made using a virus. To be specific, it is a live, infectious, modified version of HSV-1, the herpes virus variety that's usually the cause of cold sores. Though Imlygic is not especially effective by itself, its flu-like side effects are mild compared to chemotherapy. When cells turn cancerous, their virus-fighting machinery breaks down. Herpes virus prefers to attack cancer cells. When it attacks, the debris of burst-open cells alerts the immune system, and the immune system then targets the cancer cells. However, it is unclear whether the immune system targets all the cancer cells of the body or just those infected by the virus. Though Imlygic is the first to get approval in the US as a cancer treatment, it's not the only one in development. Tumor-killing viruses are a popular topic among scientists, and the idea has been around for decades. More virus-based cancer treatments may join Imlygic in the near future. Number 5. Orange virus vaccine. It's tradition to treat colds, which are caused by a virus, with orange juice. But using viruses, the orange trees themselves can fight off bugs spread by bugs. Citrus greening is a deadly disease for citrus trees. It is caused by the bacterium C. liberibacter, which is spread by sap-sucking insects. Before citrus greening came around, the most devastating orange virus was the Citrus Tristeza virus, or CTV. The virus was named after Tristeza, a Portuguese word meaning sadness, for the sadness that came with the virus's arrival. Now these two major citrus pests will be pitted against each other, with the fate of the USA's orange juice hanging in the balance. Bill Dawson, a plant pathologist from the University of Florida, modified a local strain of CTV. With this, anyone could insert new bits of DNA into the virus's genome and make it a protein factory. One of the world's largest orange juice manufacturers, Southern Garden Citrus, licensed the viral vector from Dawson's lab. With the virus as a needle, all Southern Gardens needed was something to inject. The company chose genes from spinach, which coded for antibacterial proteins called defensins. Southern Gardens plans on infecting trees with a harmless strain of CTV. Branches from CTV-infected trees would then be grafted onto other trees to spread the virus. As the virus copies itself, it becomes a spinach defensin factory, and the defensins destroy C. liberibacter. Since the biology of the tree is not modified, orange juice from these plants would not have to carry a genetically modified label. This makes getting regulatory approval much easier, sidestepping the issue of distrust of genetically modified plants. Number 4. Food poisoning protection. It's terrible to hunch over a toilet waiting to throw up and idly wonder which of the things you ate was germ-filled. Intralytics, founded in 1998, has a plan to give germs a taste of their own medicine, so to speak. It uses viruses to infect and kill bacteria that cause food poisoning. Each of its products has a mix of viruses that target the same bacteria species. The company's first product, List Shield, was approved in 2006. It is aimed at Listeria bacteria, which cause listeriosis, a kind of food poisoning with a death rate of about 20%. List Shield is meant to be applied to ready-to-eat meats, such as deli meats and hot dogs. To kill off Listeria, List Shield is sprayed on meat and the drains, floors, and surfaces of food processing plants. Intralytics' second product, EcoShield, is for the 0157H7 strain of E. coli. EcoShield is sprayed on the meat before it is ground into hamburger to kill E. coli. In studies with government investigators, Sulaik Velides showed the product killed 95% to 100% of the E. coli strain within 5 minutes. The two treatments are odorless, tasteless, invisible, and non-corrosive. The concentration of phages in the liquid spray is 0.001%, making the product as harmless as water to anything but the target bacteria. Later, another company, Microbios BV, made its own phage treatments. These were Listex P100 and Salmonellex. Listex P100 targets a Listeria species, while Salmonellex targets Salmonella. Number 3. Antibiotic viruses. Bacteriophages, or phages, are the natural enemy of bacteria. They copy themselves inside bacteria, and the bacteria eventually burst open with viruses. In the 1920s and 1930s, doctors treated a variety of infections with phages. However, phage therapy, well, it had some problems. Scientists at the time did not know phages had to be matched precisely with bacterial targets to work, which made phage treatments unreliable. In addition, people sometimes became sick from the treatments because they were not properly purified. After World War II, antibiotics were mass-produced. They were much more reliable than phages, so interest in phages declined. Though phages were mostly forgotten in the United States, they weren't forgotten in the Soviet Union. Due to the Iron Curtain blocking access to some of the best antibiotics of the West, the Soviets made do with phages and made phage therapy even more effective. In the modern day, phage therapy is administered in several forms, such as tablets, liquids, and injections, and it remains a standard treatment in Poland, Georgia, and Russia. Unlike antibiotics, phages are very precise and leave the good bacteria of the body alone. With the rise of antibiotic resistance, phages may make a comeback in the English-speaking world. Number 2. Viruses killing other viruses. You've probably heard the expression, fighting fire with fire. Well, in this case, it absolutely works, if by fire we mean HIV. In 2011, scientists at the University of California, San Diego, and UCLA made a harmless version of HIV that relies on HIV to reproduce. This virus was called a therapeutic interfering particle, or TIP. By slowing the replication of the HIV virus, TIPs might give someone 5 to 10 extra years before AIDS sets in. The TIP's genetic code was stripped to 1/3 of its original size, and it lacks important pieces needed to copy itself. The TIP can only copy itself by sneaking into HIV's genetic code. TIPs also contain HIV-inhibiting sequences and compete for the same proteins as HIV. Lior Weinberger, the leader of the team that made TIPs, likens it to a virus of a virus. According to Weinberger, TIPs could help with HIV superspreaders. These people, such as drug users, are responsible for a disproportionately large amount of HIV infection. In 2016, scientists orchestrated another virus-on-virus match, this time between reovirus and hepatitis C. During childhood, reovirus can cause colds, but by adulthood, most have become immune to it. It's like an early game enemy, inconvenient at first, but a piece of cake once you've gotten stronger. In comparison, hepatitis C, well, that's like the final boss, one that some find unbeatable. Hepatitis C is a common cause of liver cancer, and cancers originating from the liver are the third largest cause of cancer deaths worldwide. When this early game enemy is pitted against the final boss, well, it's the player, or rather the patient, who wins. When introduced to the body, reovirus stimulates a signal protein called interferon, which activates a kind of white blood cell called a natural killer cell. In experiments on human cancer samples and mice, the natural killer cells then kill the tumor and the cells infected with hepatitis C. This reovirus therapy could also be used for other cancers associated with virus infections, like Epstein-Barr virus-associated lymphoma. Number 1. Humans made by viruses. In The Matrix, bad guy Agent Smith likens humanity to a virus, a disease of the planet. In real life, he's right, to a degree. More than 45 million years ago, a mammal was infected by a retrovirus. By turning their RNA-based code to DNA, retroviruses such as HIV can sneak their instructions into the host's genome. Whenever the host cell copies itself, it also copies the virus. This ancient retrovirus happened to infect a germline cell and so could be spread to the primate ancestor's offspring. 18 years ago, in the year 2000, a team of Boston scientists discovered a strange gene in humans. This gene, called syncytin, coded for a protein made only by cells in the placenta. The two events, they are related. Syncytin comes from the virus. While the virus used that gene to fuse with a host cell, a developing fetus uses the gene to fuse some placental cells into one single-celled layer. This layer is essential for the fetus to draw nutrients from its mother. The syncytin protein comes in two varieties, the previously mentioned being syncytin 1. Reflecting its viral heritage, syncytin 2 tamps down the mother's immune system and prevents the immune system from attacking the developing fetus. HERVK inserted itself as recently as 200,000 years ago, making it the newest of all retrovirus genes in humans. It activates important genes that help with embryo development, and its viral particles and proteins help protect very young embryos from infection by other viruses. It is estimated that over 8% of human DNA actually came from viruses. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below, and do not forget to subscribe for brand new videos just like this every day of the week. Also over there on the right, some other videos that you might enjoy if you enjoyed this one. And as always, thank you for watching.